I mean, it's all funny, haha, but the stuff that was revealed with this leak is super serious. We find out that this looks bad, that America has been spying on our own allies, which might be good because one of our allies, Egypt, sort of, their president, we found out from this, is wants to send artillery to Russia, probably artillery we paid for. We found out there's an informer that we have at the highest level in the Russian military. So expect a bunch of people to be falling out of windows in Moscow next week. Oh, and I love this. We found out that Iran wants to start a space mission. Wow. They want to land on the moon, gather some moon rocks, bring them back and throw them at Israel. This thing revealed that Ukraine, that war's not going as they told us all that well. They said Ukraine very low on ammunition and we were going to send them more, but Kid Rock used it all to shoot at Bud Light.
Good morning. It is Monday, May the 1st, and this is The True Conservative. Welcome to all the butchers, bakers, and candlestick makers out there. I'm Ron, your host, and the only true conservative in the United States today. So today, after the Serenity Prayer and the Star-Spangled Banner, we will have no free lunch, the rape of the mind, commercials, gold standard, all that and more when I get back. God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing and remove your hats for the national anthem of the United States of America.
Thank you, thank you. And now, There's No Free Lunch, 250 Economic Truths by davis-bahnsen.
The principle that the end justifies the means is, in individualist ethics, regarded as the denial of all morals. In collectivist ethics, it becomes necessarily the supreme rule, F.A. Hayek. This is the unsolvable moral dilemma for socialism. It applies to the society as a whole, an ethic that we intuitively know to be unethical in our own individual lives.
And that was There's No Free Lunch by davis-bahnsen. Back in a minute. Thank you, thank you. So again, another commercial, and this is an advertisement for a television show, but it's very interesting.
Who among you is...
Dum, 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 dum.
Whose mom didn't like either of them? Who wrestled with passing the third grade? Do you ever wish you could swipe left on people in real life?
So that was, it says Jane's back, and it's for some kind of a game show, but it illustrates the culture of disrespect. This is a game show host has no respect for anybody because the people she's talking about there, when she said dumb, 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 and she says whose mother didn't like either one of them, and then they show a picture of twins, these twin candidates, but no respect, no respect. And why is it that we have a culture of no respect? It is because the left insists respect is hierarchy or deference to hierarchy, right? You respect people that are better than you. They might be smarter. They might be better than you because they are in a work hierarchy. They're your boss or the CEO. Respect because they're better athletes, because they are smarter than you, more beautiful than you, et cetera, et cetera. So this is the culture of disrespect is a direct attack on hierarchy. And so what you need to do is tell your kids, inform your kids, and tell your kids you're better than they are. Don't be afraid to say that. You're better than they are. So kids are given, your children are being given some teasing or whatever at school. You're better than they are. You're prettier than they are. You're smarter than they are. You are emphasize hierarchy. When if you're watching TV together, point it out on television. That person is smarter than that one. This person is better than that one. This person's a better athlete than that one. Teach your children. That's what you can do. Back in a minute. Thank you. And Stuart Varney and Company, and there's a reporter that's talking about the fact that J.P. Morgan took over First National Bank. So a little bit of this and then some commentary.
That the government needs to stop overspending, that's stressing the system, adding inflation. Now, on First Republic, a Treasury official gives us this quote about it, saying that Treasury is encouraged. This institution was resolved with the least cost to depositors insurance fund in a manner that protected all depositors, adding that the banking system remains sound and resilient. So what we're seeing is a massive shift of deposits leaving smaller banks and headed for larger ones. It started with the fall of Silicon Valley Bank, now bad management decisions at smaller banks, less regulated banks, are being exposed. So later today, the FDIC is going to unveil its plan and options for the future to possibly revise the insurance deposit fund in order to add more confidence to the banking system. Stu?
Got it.
So all of this reminds me of what kind of an economic system do we have? We're not socialist. We're not capitalist. We have some kind of a weird hybrid, and it's called Keynesian. It's a Keynesian economic system. The whole world is on the same economic system. This is the reason that socialism never works, is because socialism is a economic system separate and apart from Keynes. Okay, so everybody has to be on the same economic system in order to be able to trade with one another. Otherwise, you're going to have financial problems. Now, having said that, the Keynesian economic system was a system that was developed in order to create to get rid of the boom, what the left used to call boom and bust cycles of the economy, so that we would have ever increasing prosperity, so that my children would do better than I, and that their children would do better than them. Ever increasing prosperity. So, and it's failed. It's failed over and over and over again. We still have boom and bust cycles. Now we have banks that are going bad. Keynesian economics hasn't solved any of those problems. And so what that means is we need to restore the gold standard. The gold standard needs to be restored. We experimented with Keynes. We gave it a shot. We started this in the 1970s when Richard Nixon took us off the gold standard. And it has been one disaster after another. Okay, it has solved nothing. It has given government a bunch of apparent power, although they don't seem to have done much with it. And in the meantime, it has inflated our money supply. It has created pollution. It has funded wars. so that the planet is a lot less peaceful. And so for those, at least those three reasons, we should restore the gold standard, because you bring in a gold standard, the price of gold has a tendency to go up. That means your buying power has a tendency to go up. That means prices are going to have a tendency to go down. Now, unfortunately, so will wages, but you don't need your wages to go up because of the value of your money continues to increase. And that's without putting it in the bank and without putting it at risk on Wall Street. You can put gold in your mattress and it will underneath your mattress and it will increase in value. So you're not going to be the emphasis is not going to be on purchasing. Buy. And buying junk, buying plastic, buying garbage that you're going to end up throwing away. Nobody is going to trade gold for plastic. Now we have a gold standard economy. Our standards in terms of what it is that we're going to buy is going to go up. Our expectations are going to go up. And we're going to put purchases off. We're going to say, you know what? I'm not going to buy that new car right now because the price is only going to come down next year. So I'll wait until next year. I'll wait until next year to buy all kinds of other things. If we're not consuming, we're not throwing as much stuff in the garbage. It stands to reason. Also, if we're buying items of quality, where we're insisting on getting value for the gold, then we are more likely to repair what we have purchased instead of just throwing it away. Right now, you're going to go out and get plastic. That's what you trade for paper, plastic. And so when you get plastic and it breaks, it's not worth repairing. So you throw it in the garbage, but not in a gold standard economy. Anyways, to sum up, the banks are now, we got some bank failures that are going on. I don't think it's going to be an overall catastrophe. I think that this is going to be able to be contained. But then again, I'm not a specialist in this area. So, but it definitely points to the fact that Keynesian economics is dead and that we should restore the gold standard as soon as possible. Back in a minute. Thank you, thank you. And now, the rape of the mind, logicide.
Logocide. Byfield points out in his pamphlet on logicide that words are commonly used as instruments of social revolution. Politicians seeking power must coin new labels and new words with emotional appeal, while allowing the same old practices and institutions to continue as before. The trick is to replace a disagreeable image, though the substance remains the same. The totalitarians consequently have to fabric a hate language in order to stir up the mass emotions. We all have experienced how the word peace doesn't mean peace anymore. It has become a propagandistic device to appease the masses and to disguise aggression. The verbocracy in totalitarian thinking and the official verbosity of demagogues serves to disturb and suffocate the free minds of citizens. We can say that verbocracy turns them into what psychology calls symbol agnostics, people capable only of imitation, incapable of the inquisitive sense of objectivity and perspective that leads to questioning and understanding, and the formation of individual ideas and ideals. In other words, the individual citizen becomes a parrot, repeating ready-made slogans and propaganda catchwords without understanding what they really mean or what forces stand behind them. This parrotism may give the citizen of totalitaria a certain infantile emotional pleasure. However, heil, heil, deuce, deuce, these rhythmic chants afford him the same kind of sound enjoyment children achieve through babbling, shrieking, and yelling. The abuse of the word and the enshrinement of propaganda are more obvious in totalitaria than any other part of the world. But this evil exists all over. We can find all too many examples of it in actual conversation. Many speakers use verbal showing off to cover an emptiness of thought, to stir up emotions, and to create admiration and adoration of what is essentially empty and valueless. Loud-mouthed phoniness threatens to become the ideal of our time. The semantic fog in totalitaria is thickened by the regimentation of information. The citizens of our mythical country have no access to sources of facts and opinions. They are not free to verify what they hear or read. They are the victims of their leaders' libelomania. Their judgments are determined by the official labels everything and everybody bears.
And that was Logocide from The Rape of the Mind by joost-meerlo, M.D. Back in a minute.
Thank you.
This is Ron, your host, the only true conservative in the United States today, bidding adios to all the butchers, bakers, and candlestick makers out there. So I'm reminding you that the left has no authority, no power, and they can't win.